Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Chuck, and I want to welcome you to Stonebriar Community Church for an obvious reason of remembering the man we all loved. I'm just going to break a mold here, since Steve did that all the time. I'm going to have you all stand and tell the person near you where you first met Steve Farrar. Stand up. Let's go after it. All right, thank you. Thank you. My pleasure to welcome all of you who are present and all of you who are viewing this special memorial service online. We extend to you a welcome as well. Thank you for taking time today to join with us in this wonderful occasion. I feel honored because today you have a chance to meet a man I've respected and loved for years, named Stu Weber, highly decorated veteran from Vietnam War, Green Beret. Thank you, Stu, for doing what you're going to do, and for having done what you have done, for what you meant to Steve. Thank you. Carl Sandburg wrote what I would call his magnum opus when he did his four-volume work on Lincoln, the War Years. He may have been weary by the time he reached that fourth volume, because when he got to chapter 75, he couldn't think of a title that would be appropriate for covering the time following our 16th president's death. Sandburg was moved over it, as his words reveal. He wanted just the right words for that chapter title. He chose an old woodsman's proverb, and that became the chapter title in that fourth volume, chapter 75, "A tree is best measured when it's down." All his life, Steve Farrar has been up. And we all loved him and leaned on him and listened to him and laughed with him and sometimes wept with him. And now he's down. Well, he's really up. So I stand corrected. Right. But you know what I mean. Now that he is where we can measure him, we're still at a loss for words. And you'll hear that in the pauses, and you'll see it in the tears, and you will feel it from those who share today. Our hearts go out to you, Mary, to your children, now adults, your grandchildren, the family of Steve that goes on and on. We express our profound feelings of sympathy. Each person who speaks or sings is going to attempt to measure this marvelous tree that grew among us and spread its leafy branches to shade our lives, to remind us that there is a hope, there is a reason to go on. We love you, Steve Farrar, and we thank you for all you meant to us. We will miss you forever. Thank you for being here. Please enter into this without once looking at your watch. Okay? Don't worry. You have no better place to be than right here. And no better one to listen to than Stu Weber. And join me in welcoming him, will you please?
He's always been my hero for a long time. A man who stands by the Lord Jesus Church. I love it. And though I don't know many of you, I love you because you're here because you loved my friend. We're gathered here to memorialize an unusual human being who lived right in our midst. We're going to remember. You'll hear a lot of remembrances today. Remember is one of the major verbs in all of Scripture. The Lord told his people in the repeating of the law, Deuteronomy, you must remember all the way I have led you in this wilderness. And if you forget, you will perish. And the New Testament tells us all these things were written for our benefit. So we must remember. It's very important to remember, which means to reflect, it's recall, it's reflect, and it's react, it's respond, as Chuck just said, participate, participate. Maybe we can measure our lives by this highly effective one that we memorialize today. Steve had, as you know, two overriding earthly passions on this planet. God's Word, his Bible, and his family. Those were the two. They're the major input into his life. He was always talking about his Lord and his Word and his kids. So right now, coming down the aisle here, are the grandchildren, some of them, for generations, carrying Steve's Bible to place it at the center of the assembly so that we all remember what this man was all about. Thank you, Holden. I'm really tempted to just start reading the notes. I loved this man. I loved him deeply, powerfully, strongly, even though we didn't get to always spend a lot of time together. But like Steve, he was always leading, and he's going to lead us now in prayer. Mary and I talked the other day. She discovered this prayer that Steve had preached. He actually prayed before he preached in the men's Bible study here at Stonebriar just a few years ago. And in it, you will begin measuring the man. I knew him for many years. And I see, every time I see him, I see maturity. I see maturity and quietness, highly unusual for Steve. Gentleness, not particularly a first-rate category for him, but he was a man who was molded by God's word, and he talked to God. He read his Bible every day. In fact, in a year, the course of a year, he read it through several times. And he read his family every day, and he spent time with them. So Steve's going to lead us in prayer. You're free to be seated. You know, the Bible doesn't require that we bow our heads and close our eyes, and you'll want to watch, because the man's heart and soul is part of the prayer. But you are required to come before God, submissive to his will and intentions, and humble in your heart. So let's humbly bow in prayer in our hearts and be led by our brother whom we love so much.
Father, I was reading the other day Psalms and came across 134. And just that one line, it says, "The Lord will accomplish that which concerns me." That takes a lot of stress off. We don't exist by chance. We're not accidents. We're not a result of time and chance. We're a result of your plan before the foundations of the world. David said, "Your eyes have seen my unformed substance." One of the most amazing scriptures in all the Bible. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance. When he was in the womb, you fashioned him as you did us. When we were actually just a sperm and an egg, you knew us. We weren't formed. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in thy book they were all written in the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. That is an incredible statement. So no one in here is an accident. No one in here is here by chance. We exist by your will. You determined the moment of our conception, our birth. It's appointed for a man once to die, Hebrews says, so you've appointed the day that we die. Until then, we're immortal. We can't die. Doesn't mean we can't get hurt. Doesn't mean we can't get injured. Doesn't mean we can't have things happen that should take us out, but they don't take us out because Psalm 68 says, "To the Lord belongs escapes from death." Because you will accomplish what concerns me. That's true of every one of us in this room. There's a reason we're alive. We don't begin to really find it until Christ breaks into our lives and pulls us to himself. And then things start coming together because we've been given a new life and a new heart. If any man's in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things pass away. All things become new. And then we start the journey to become mature men. And we're on it until we take our dying breath. And when we take that dying breath, it's promotion. To die is gain. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord and to never suffer again, ever. You wipe away all tears forever. So it takes the stress off that you will accomplish what concerns us. You know what's best, we don't. We would like to avoid all suffering, but you don't allow that. There are lessons to be taught in the valley of suffering that we would learn nowhere else. David said, "It was good for me that I was afflicted." We can all say that. An easy life does nothing for us. It does nothing for our souls. We become spoiled. We become flabby. We begin to think we must be special because everything goes our way. We get proud. So, Father, even in the difficulties of life, which you oversee, there is a purpose. We're not always in difficulty, but there are seasons that have a beginning, a middle, and they have an end. And we come out better from those seasons as a result of being in them. We're better men coming out than we were going in. Now, Lord, these are truths from your word that we need to be reminded of. You've been so gracious and kind and merciful to us. Tonight, as we study your word, I pray that you would give us perspective. It's easy to lose perspective. It's easy for us to get out of balance. Like, every once in a while, we got to take our cars in and align the front ends, because they start wobbling on us. We start wobbling sometimes. We get out of alignment because we're not thinking straight. We're not thinking biblically. So we're going down the road of life. We hit certain potholes that throw us. We're not sure what you're doing. Align us tonight, we pray. Get us in sync. And as you do, you'll encourage us and lift our hearts and lift our spirits. Put courage in our hearts, we ask tonight, for every man. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand.
To the Lord, the Almighty, the King of Creation.
Well, we are here to say goodbye to my big brother, Steve, who had my back my whole life. Problem was, he thought he had my front, too, so it caused a few issues, but we worked through it. But I thought, from a perspective as someone who grew up with Steve, I was thinking about what was distinctive of him as growing up. And Steve was, from an early age, a deep thinker. He really was. He read a lot. He thought a lot. And somehow, he just knew all three of us boys were going to be leaders and make an impact. Steve just believed that. So I believed it. And much of what I am today is a direct result of my brothers believing I could be that. I didn't know enough to say, I can't do that. Of course, that caused some issues on the other end. I thought I could do anything and ran into some issues, but that's how we learn, isn't it? I remember Steve being so serious about us walking with the Lord, even as youngsters. I remember one time, I think Steve was a freshman in high school, maybe, Mom. He was like 16. And I was like 13 or 14. I have to be 12. Anyone have a calculator? No, I'm teasing. He was like 12. By the way, there's so many people here that from our past that the names are hard to grab. So I know I'm trying to get my kids to wear name tags, and they're not cooperating. So we got to work with each other here. But early on, Steve like had such a commitment to us living right. I remember talking Mom, trying to kind of a con on my mom to let me go to a party in junior high school. And Steve has the gall, you remember this? To say to my mother, don't let him go, he's conning you. And I said to myself, that guy needs a hobby. He needs to leave me alone, you know? But that's the context we grew up in. And it had tremendous fruits and benefits in our lives. One thing we grew up with that's so significant to me is the right to question. And you guys knew Steve was a very strong man with great convictions. My dad was like that on steroids. I mean, Dad was such a strong man. And we went to a church every Sunday. We'd get dressed up and go. And on the way home, though, as we hit age of awareness, and Steve and Mike were teenagers, and I was in junior high, so I listened into everything, we would discuss what had happened at church. And a lot of it was goofy. Churches have goofy people in them. Number one, they're full of sinners. We shouldn't be shocked at that. And we discuss in detail the sermon. And we were in a context where Steve and my brother Mike were kind of coming out of some beliefs we were raised with and trying to match those up to how we understood the scripture, and we would go after it. And I remember there was a time where every family holiday, Mom would say, okay, no fighting this year over predestination, you know, and over propitiation. And let's leave that outside and enjoy the turkey, and we'd go at it. And, you know, in those days, you had to defend what you believed. That sounds weird to us today, but we lived in a day in the 60s where people were wrestling with what they believed. I remember reading Francis Schaeffer as an eighth grader. Didn't understand a thing, but I read that book. And talking about these theological issues, and from that, we learned to stand by what we believed. No one gave in very easy. But today, you're not even allowed to believe anything. Because today, you know, if you believe something, that implies someone else might be wrong about what they believe. Well, you can't say that. So basically, we're all reduced to where nothing is true. Just whatever suits you. Some of you are younger that don't understand why some of us have such deep convictions. We grew up in a day when you had to defend yourself. Liberals would go after you. We grew up in San Francisco. Steve got out of there pretty quick. And moved down to God's country. I thrived on it. I loved it because of the diversity, and there were so many casualties to the world's lies. And Steve used to say, you are exactly where you need to be. And Steve had this sense that I could never be Steve. I never wanted to be Steve. I couldn't be Mike, but I could be me. And Steve was an encourager for that. And so
You learn to defend yourself. And I would just say this. I want to honor my brother. I loved him deeply, which is why in the last few years we had a few skirmishes and disagreements over how to handle stuff. It broke my heart. And Steve was so kind to keep coming back and reestablishing contact. And I really believe that the honesty saved us from having to rebel within our own home. The right to tell the truth, whether it was right or not. The right to stand on what we believed until we were convinced from Scripture. That made us who we are. But you know what? Forgiveness and respect and tenderness are what redeemed his life. A lot of strong men around. But you take a strong man who's tender and quick to acknowledge he might have stepped over the line. And all we can do is love him and forgive him. We're going to hear some great stuff today, so hold on to your hats. It's going to be good.
The first Sunday of November in 1978, my wife and I decided to attend a new church. We had just gotten married and hadn't decided where we were going to attend in the new community. Having grown up in church, I gave my wife a brief tutorial on how to church shop. First, you show up right before the service starts. Then you sit in the very back. And then you see how you feel about the service and the music. And once it's over, you slide out quickly without talking to anyone. This was not her style at all, but she agreed. However, much to her surprise, she saw that I was captivated by the young preacher. He was really, really good. And to her utter amazement, at the end of the service, instead of rushing out the back door, I was headed up to the front to introduce myself. As you've probably guessed, the young preacher was Steve. He and Mary had just taken that pastorate about 6 months earlier. This was the start of a long and deep friendship. As a side note, we're still attending that church after 43 years. So much for church shopping. Within a few days, we were having dinner with Steve and Mary and meeting little Rachel, meeting Mike, Steve's middle brother, and his delightful wife, Kathy, and soon his parents. Quickly, we were embraced by the entire Farrar clan. Now, if this hasn't happened to you yet, it's like being recruited into a Cirque du Soleil performance. There are more people doing more things at the same time. You can't possibly take it all in. You just need to go with it. At the time, we were two young guns in our 20s, long on truth and not long enough on grace, trying to figure out the Lord's will in our lives. This began a lifetime of long conversations, sharing our biggest dreams, wishes, and fears. The amazing thing about our friendship was that we could go months without talking or seeing each other, but could pick up the conversation as if it was started that very morning. And we talked about everything, all the highs and also all the lows that life brought. And there were plenty of both. We committed to each other that we would tell the truth even if it hurt. And there were times when it stung. As part of that friendship, I made a goal of mine that I would run every major decision through a handful of guys who knew me best. I trusted that the Lord would speak through them to me, even if I didn't like what I heard. Steve was the first of those key guys. Steve learned to be an amazing listener. I could ask him anything and know that he would listen carefully and then give godly counsel. He immersed himself into the scriptures so deeply that when he spoke into my life, it was like deep, pure honey being applied to my raspy, sore soul. As we got older, we both stayed deeply committed to the truth and learned much more about grace in our own lives and those around us. And it became evident that we both felt very blessed with the wives the Lord had given us. How proud we were of each of our kids and how well they had married. And we both loved being grandpas. Steve would just chuckle, and he had a great chuckle when he would talk about the time he got with these little ones. How he loved his family. Now, as a way to honor him, I want to leave with you some of his advice to me. These two pieces have become very special. Both are out of his admiration and study of the Puritans, by the way. The first goes like this. God's providence is like the Hebrew language. It is best understood looking at it from right to left. Meaning, while life may not make a lot of sense at the moment, being able to look back on it years later will show you God's plans were in place all the time. Steve and I talked a lot about seeing God's fingerprints on so much of our lives. The second is regarding the challenge of discerning God's sense of timing. It's an area that I'm currently wrestling with. Here it is. God always takes his time, but he never wastes time. As I embrace how much I miss Steve already, and realize that I can't talk to him the same way anymore, and I can't ask him questions like, why does the Lord take really godly guys home earlier than it seems he should? I know what he would say, because I have 43 years of conversations to remember. I am so honored to be called his friend and to have known him so long. Bev, and Mary, and family, our heart goes out to you. But be comforted by Steve's deep love and pride in you all. It was real, and it was great.
Good afternoon. My name is Jeff Scruggs, and I gotta tell you how honored and humbled I am to be here today to honor Steve. He wasn't just my favorite Bible teacher, but he was my close friend. My wife and I met Steve and Mary in 2005. We had just shared our testimony at the Village Church about how God had restored our marriage after 7 years of divorce. Steve came up after the service to thank us for sharing our testimony. It was then I was able to tell him about the role he had played and how his teachings had ministered to my heart during those 7 years when I was in a very dark place in my life. He invited us to dinner that night to the Cotton Patch, and our friendship began. He told me about his Bible study here at Stonebriar, which I've now been a part of for the last 17 years. I was right back there in the sit back right there in the center field bleachers, and he would tease us about that every week. Steve's faith in God was so contagious, and each week he would remind us guys of God's sovereign plan for our lives, God's providence, God's grace, and that God's word is a gift to all of us to be handled correctly and diligently and daily. Steve had a way of incorporating humor in his studies that made him even more relatable to the guys. And he talked about one of these passages in his prayer today, and that was Psalm 139:16. And as he would teach about God's sovereignty, he often referenced that verse. And he spoke about how our days are numbered before we were born. And after that verse, sometimes jokingly, he would say, "So guys, go eat a cheeseburger." I experienced Steve in real time living out Philippians 2:3-4. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Steve and I, along with several other men from the centerfield bleachers, would go to dinner after Bible study on a regular occasion. Many of these men were going through real struggles, troubled marriages, addictions, some were fighting depression, and some had grown up in a home without a dad. It was amazing to me to watch Steve, after he had already taught the Bible study, muster up the energy to listen to these guys and offer up encouragement by sharing the truth and his own experiences. Steve knew if he could help the men, he would be helping the entire family. He was real, authentic, humble. He was a man's man. And we felt his sincere concern and care, God's love for all of us. Another one of Steve's favorite verses that he often quoted in Bible study was Ecclesiastes 7:14. In the day of prosperity, rejoice. In the day of adversity, consider. God made one as well as the other. In a way, this verse defined our friendship. Steve, Mary, Cheryl, and I were all enjoying life and excited about what God was doing in our families. We would get together regularly for dinners. Steve and I enjoyed walking the property at Post Oak as we talked about our kids and sports and politics. When they moved to their new home, some of my favorite memories were sitting on his patio with a roaring fire in the fireplace as we contemplated life. All of these conversations were peppered with God's word. Steve was easy to talk to, and we offered a safe place for each other to talk about whatever we were going through. Almost every visit ended with us praying together. These were intimate times. In 2011, my daughter was in a terrible life-threatening accident where she was in a fight for her life for many days. The night of the accident, I texted Steve for prayers at 1 a.m. and told him of Lauren's accident. Steve woke up Mary and they drove to Parkland Hospital, 45 minutes away from their house. They spent hours with us that night. He came to the hospital or called me every day for the next 3 weeks, as well as helping me navigate important decisions to be made. I leaned on Steve during a time when I was in great despair and could barely even think clearly. He cheered us on as a family. He cheered us on as a family as Lauren progressed and beat every best case scenario that her doctors had laid out for her. He celebrated her accomplishments with us, and we all marveled at God's provision. That's what a true friend looks like. I will forever treasure the conversations we had, his sense of humor, his wisdom, his compassion, his gift to tell stories, our prayers together, and the way he modeled how a godly man lived out every aspect of his life. He ran the race with perseverance. He loved Jesus, his Savior. Mary, his wife, was his best friend, and I witnessed his kindness and understanding to her. I admired the love and tenderness he showed his mom, Bev, as he would take her hand and walk her to her room every night. He had a fierce love for his children and grandchildren, and his presence in their lives was a blessing for me to watch as he molded and encouraged me to love my family the same way he loved his. He lived what he taught. More recently, I've been in another season of adversity, battling cancer, receiving treatment, experiencing healing, and now a reoccurrence. Steve showed that he cared with his presence, his prayers, his timely sage wisdom, and his encouragement. He called me after every blood test, every doctor's appointment, and every scan. After hearing from Mary that Saturday evening of Steve's passing, I was shocked, and probably in shock, and couldn't sleep. I got up, and the thing I could think about most was getting out my Bibles. I have three of them from the 17 years that I've listened to Steve preach, and I got them out, And I started flipping through Psalms, Proverbs, Isaiah, and reading the nuggets of wisdom that I had written in the margins from Steve's teachings. Several of the passages I had marked Steve Farrar, indicating that these reminded me of Steve. In the days to come, when you think of Steve, remember his great love for God's word and pick up your Bible and read some of his favorite passages. One of my favorites that defines who Steve was is Psalm 1, 1-3. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by the streams of water that yields its fruit in season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. Now I'd like to read a quote. And this book, The Red Sea Rules, is really special to me. But one of the reasons it's really special to me is Steve brought me his copy when my daughter was in the hospital. He's marked it up. He's written things like great quote. He's circled. He's underlined. He's highlighted. He read this book many times. And I want to read this poem that Vance Havner, he was a North Carolina evangelist, and he wrote this poem after the passing of his wife. And it goes like this. When before the throne we stand in him complete, all the riddles that puzzle us here will fall into place, and we shall know in fulfillment what we now believe in faith, that all things work together for good in his eternal purpose. No longer will we cry, my God, why? Instead, alas, it will become alleluia. All question marks will be straightened into exclamation points. Sorrow will change to singing, and pain will be lost in praise. I'm going to miss my dear friend. I loved him greatly. And now at this time, Rachel, his daughter, is going to come and sing. Steve loved to hear Rachel sing. And today, she's gonna share with us one of Steve's favorites. It's an old familiar hymn. I'm sure that many of you have heard it before. Jesus, I am panicking. Rachel. Actually, she's gonna sing a sweet, sweet hymn. Jesus, I am resting.
Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what thou art. I am finding out the greatness of thy loving heart. Thou hast bid me upon thee, and thy beauty fills my soul. And by thy transforming power, thou hast made me whole. Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what thou art. I am finding out the greatness of thy loving heart.
It's a big place in here. Steve would be, he would be humbled to look out on this congregation and those in attendance today. I'm Bryan Owens, brother-in-law of Steve, an outsider in some respects. But you know, those Farrars can be kind of clannish. Nevertheless, Steve welcomed me into the family. My wife Sharon and Steve's wife Mary are sisters. I'm a founder and CEO to a number of related companies, but when I first met Steve, that was all a pipe dream. Steve is my pastor and discipler. And I was just, and he was just starting to write a book about male leadership in the home based on his seminary dissertation. We both saw our lives pass before our eyes a number of times as our work progressed, but more on that later. Over the past 35 years, Steve played a number of roles in my life. Beyond pastor, he was a matchmaker. He and Mary, probably mostly Mary, were responsible for me meeting the love of my life, Sharon. He performed our wedding ceremony, which we just rewatched over Christmas with our kids and our daughters-in-law. He started out the message saying, "Sharon, you look fabulous." He went on to say, "Bryan, well, you look fair." And he said, "Truthfully, you both never look better." And he was right, except for Sharon. And it's all downhill from there. Steve and I, we worked together. We lived beside one another. They had 22 acres in Copper Canyon. We had 10 just across a creek. I built a timber frame bridge connecting our properties. We raised cows and kids together. Both turning out to be harder than we anticipated. The only time the cows got out was when I was on the road, so. Stephen was, in effect, my theology professor. He was also my advisor, confidant, and most importantly, one of my dearest friends. We had years of experience and trust built up and could share even the deepest and most vulnerable of our struggles. I could tell you story after story of times with Steve that would make you laugh and cry. But what I want to do today is share some of the richest lessons and practices that he taught me. The three most influential people in my life have been my mom. She taught me about Jesus. She taught me to love the Word of God and good Christian books. My precious wife, Sharon. My soulmate, companion, lover, and whose counsel I value the most. Steve Farrar. Steve modeled for me what it means to be a godly husband, father, leader, and friend. Like many men here today, Steve called out something in me to step up as a man of God. I've often said about Steve that Steve, the writer and speaker, is the same Steve at home and in his close relationships. He is remarkably authentic in public and private, and that, as we know, is a rare combination in this world today. What you saw in public is who he really, really, I say is, because he's still alive. It's just not with us. Steve was very open about his own struggles in life. He often spoke about his depression that he had when he was in his early 30s. Steve's vulnerability opened the door for me to call on him at times when I was in the pit. That helped take the power out of my own struggles, and it normalized them. We talked about life a lot, the challenge of leadership, the lonely whine of the top dog, to borrow a phrase from Pastor Swindoll. We often talked about family, marriage, and raising kids, which frequently led to the powerful topic of prayer. Steve taught me that combining prayer with fasting, it is the nuclear option. And we both employed it in hard times. We saw God move mountains for us that came from this persistent and often impudent praying. Steve taught me the importance of theology and doctrine. He awakened in me a robust respect and trust, as we've already heard, in the sovereignty of God in all of our affairs, in the affairs of the world. No doubt he'd be employing that foundational trust in light of the events going on in our world today. I could just hear the conversations we'd be saying. I can hear his counsel now. From our conversations and his writings, I learned more about the Reformers and the Puritan writers, the richness of their faith, their unshakable trust in the sovereign creator of the universe, even as they lived under tremendous adversity. And as we saw the procession come in with the grandchildren, that was taken from the practice of the Reformers, as they would come in to the church, as the pastor, the minister would come into the church, he would hold high the word of God as he walked down the aisle. Steve often quoted from the Reformers and the Puritans some of these themes you may have already heard today. John Flavel said, "Some providences of God are like the Hebrew writings. They're best understood backwards." And isn't that true in our lives? He quoted Thomas Watson on sin, "Repentance is the vomiting of the soul." It's pretty graphic, pretty poignant. I'd say that Steve's most favorite preacher was from the early to mid 20th century, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. No doubt if you've heard Steve speak, you've heard him speak about Lloyd-Jones. Steve read all his works. In the wake of the Great Recession in 2008 and 2009, which greatly impacted my businesses and maybe many of us out in the audience, I'm sure, Steve quoted Lloyd-Jones saying, "Stare the worst in the face. Know this, if the worst thing did happen, God will still make a way. It would be his mercy." Probably the biggest thing Steve learned from Lloyd-Jones was the importance of right thinking. Remind yourself of the truths of God's word. He would say Christianity is all about thinking. Thinking biblically, reminding ourselves, speaking to ourselves, taking ourselves in hand, rebutting the fiery darts that come from the evil one with the truths of Holy Scripture. I get some of my best stuff from Sharon. She reminded me recently, in every situation, Steve always, always, always started with the Word of God, and he applied it to what he was facing into life's dilemmas. He never started with trying to be culturally relevant like many do today, who start there first and then bring Scripture in to address felt needs. Steve began with Scripture, and Steve ended with Scripture. It always resulted in right thinking when we align ourselves with the Word of God. It's amazing. Steve calmed his soul with Scripture unlike anyone that I have ever known. For Steve, the Word of God was like oxygen for his lungs and a highly effective blood pressure medication. He literally couldn't live without it. He told me a story once about he was having some blood pressure issues, and he was on his way, I think, to get his blood pressure checked, and he began to recite scripture to calm his soul and remind himself of who God was. And he did so remarkably. He walked into a CVS or a Walgreens, and he stuck his arm in a blood pressure cuff, and as he was still reciting scripture to calm himself, and he looked and he saw his blood pressure return to normal. And that's a true story. On Saturday night, 2 weeks ago, at 11:50 p.m., I received the most jarring text of my life. Mary texted me, "Bryan, Steve just died. Please call." It was a gut punch, and I did not want to believe it. Over the next few days, I felt not only a deep, sad loss, but also felt a sort of panic. For the past 3.5 decades, Steve was my guy. The man I turned to when I was facing complex issues, struggles, and trials. We talked things through. We searched God's word and prayed. And I'd walk away with clarity, a wise perspective, and peace. Even over the past 2 weeks, I found myself wanting to call Steve and work through this devastating loss of Steve. It's weird, isn't it? But Steve's gone, leaving in his place a sense of fear and unsettledness. Once again, my wife enters in. I shared my feelings with Sharon, and she said to me, "That must have been the way the disciples felt when Jesus told them he was leaving them and going back to the Father." In John 14, Jesus told his disciples, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. These things I have spoken to you while I'm still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you." If Steve were here today, he would say to me, "You don't need me. You have the Word of God, the ultimate helper, the Spirit of the living God. He will never leave you or forsake you." Well, in fact, in retrospect, what Steve always did was merely point me to God. Now a postscript. When I first met Steve, he was working on the material for what would become his first and best-selling book, Point Man. It became the seminal book on Christian male leadership in the home and the pivot point for Steve to leave the pastorate and minister directly to men, which he's done for 3 decades. After writing over 20 books, Steve's publisher asked Steve to focus on an updated Point Man and to write, in effect, Point Man 2.0 for the book's 30th anniversary. He began his writing project several years ago and stopped and started many times. The changes in our culture over the last 30 years have been so profound that the book required a whole new approach to be meaningful. And he labored over this book, I think, more than any other. Mary's nodding her head. He finally turned in his last draft about a year ago. Soon after that, Sharon and I were having dinner with Steve and Mary, and I asked him about the status of Point Man 2.0. And he said, "It's done, and it's with a publisher finally." And he said, "I think this will be the last book I'll ever write." I thought to myself, Surely Steve doesn't mean that. But he did. And he was right. Steve is home with Jesus now. His work here is done, and he won't be writing any more books. No more Bible studies. But that's not the end of the story. God's timing to take Steve home is laden with irony. Don't you love it? It gives me pleasure to say that the 30th anniversary edition of Point Man will be released in a few weeks, just in time for Father's Day. Looks like Steve has a few more things to say. Thank you.
Steve Farrar is my best friend. In the night that Steve died, John called, left me a message, Mary texted. I didn't see it till 3 a.m., but I always go to the bathroom at 3 a.m., so I saw it, Mary. And I woke up Barb, and I told Barb, and I went into my office, and I journaled scores of memories and found, much like Jeff Scruggs mentioned, 23 citations in the Word of God where Steve was in the margin, and then I wept. The next morning, Cooper, my son-in-law, was in the home with his family, was visiting, and he woke up and he said, you know, Gary, Steve had such gravitas in your life. It is as if you have woken up this morning and a planet is missing from the solar system. Steve has been my best friend for 34 years. When we met in 1988, I met him the same day I met you, Stu. The Three Amigos, it was the birth of the Three Amigos, and we were all together in Memphis, and Barb and Mary were sitting in between Steve and I at a barbecue joint, and we were all working on a marriage ministry, and Steve leaned back and he said, so you're a counselor, and I said, yes, and he said, I could have used you a few years ago. And we got up and went out into the parking lot, and Mary and Barb found us about an hour later, just connecting. And from that point on, we connected. In 1990, I helped him start his ministry and have served on that board and somehow became the chairman. I think I was the only one who wanted to do that, but became the chairman of that deal. But we have countless memories of writing and speaking and traveling and ups and downs and losses and gains for Christ and setbacks and book conventions. Josh, I remember you in a Marriott hotel at a book convention doing flips all the way down some hallway. We were trying to go to bed, and then you're chasing DC Talk down the street. We didn't know what you would do when you caught DC Talk, but they happened to be at the good book convention, and all these memories. Steve and Mary loved our kids, and we loved you three. I have these citations. One of them is Psalm 119:105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. And many times it was as if Steve was holding the lantern in the path of my life. And I'm just going to briefly share. Steve taught me a number of things. One thing he taught me is that God is sovereign. How many of you believe that God is sovereign? God is sovereign. And he would remind me that God would make a way. One time our daughter, who flew down from Chicago to be here to honor Steve with her daughter Lillian, Missy was having a tumor removed from her mouth, and she was coming out of anesthesia and heard the surgeon say something about malignancy, and she said, Dad, what is malignancy? And I didn't know what to do. I went to the hallway. I called Steve, and I couldn't talk. And he said, Gary, faith is the refusal to panic. Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, come what may. He said, Gary, repeat after me, faith is the refusal to panic. Faith is the refusal to panic. And I remember just sobbing as my brother moved close to me, but remembering that faith is the refusal to panic. God is sovereign. He was also the kind of man that showed up in my life, and nothing was more clear to me than in 1996, my dad had died. We buried him, Stu. 2 days later, you and Steve and I were at Fort Worth at Will Rogers Auditorium doing one of our men's events, And Stu and Steve sat on the front row, and I'm up there talking, and they said, are you going to say anything to these guys that you just buried your dad on Wednesday? I didn't have any intent to say anything to the guys. I started burying the pain, stuffed it down, ended up in a clinical depression, and about 4 months later, trying to weave my way and find my way through this, 3 or 4 months later, Steve called one day to just check in. And I didn't return the call. I had no intention of returning the call because I was hiding. I was scared to death. And Steve called Barb and went home, and Mary said, did Gary call you back? No, he didn't call me back. She said, what are you going to do? And he said, I'm going to fly up to Des Moines tonight. So he called Barb, got a ticket, flew up. I was in bed at 8 o'clock, scared to death to deal with my pain. The next morning, I woke up, and Barb said, you're not going into the ministry today. Steve is in the next room. And I said, in my house. And she said, Steve's here. I walked out. He was in his gym trunks. He wasn't particularly handsome in his gym trunks at that stage. And he said, you're ticked, aren't you? And I said, no, but I was, because there was nowhere to run. And I said, well, let's have some coffee. And he didn't drink coffee, so he had tea, which was the most effeminate thing about Steve Farrar. It was the only effeminate thing about Steve Farrar was he would drink tea. And we went downstairs, and he stayed, John and Rachel and Josh, for 2.5 days. There's a guy giving me heartburn. He went and confronted the guy and fired him. He said, if you have a question, you come to me. He helped rescue me. And Josh, the most poignant part of that memory was you at a soccer game. You don't remember this. You'd have no reason to remember this. But you called, and Barb gave you the phone, and said, can I talk to my dad? And we didn't have cell phones, so he was on a landline, and Steve said, Josh, I'm not coming home for your soccer game. I'm here with Gary. And Josh, you said, oh, don't leave Gary, Dad. Don't leave Gary. You stay with Gary. You stay with Gary. And he stayed. He loved me. We broke through the pain. And it changed my life. Countless times, he stood with me. So he was a friend. And he stood with me, and he showed up. But the last thing, and I'll leave you with it, is we had fun, usually around rental cars. And the Farrars and the Rosbergs were at a Christian bookseller convention. Kids, you'll probably remember this, and we were all in a Suburban, and Mary, we were going to Disney World, where you got out the itinerary and told us what to do, and we lost you after 10 minutes. But on the way to Disney World in the Suburban, Steve missed the exit by about 30 yards. But that didn't deter Steve, because Mary had an itinerary. We had to get to Disney World. And so he goes on the grass about 100 yards. Rachel, do you remember this? And we ended up on a road. And I turned to him and he said, it's a rental. But the best rental story, Stu, and you don't remember this because we never told you. The three amigos, Stu and Steve, and the other guy, that was me, Gary, we all written books, and Tender Warrior, and Guard Your Heart, and Steve's Point Man, and we were doing a men's event at Ed Young's place down there in Houston, and it was lunchtime, and Steve, with his mischievous manner, leaned over and said, you know what, if we can get Stu to do the last two talks, I've got 4 tickets, and we can take John and Josh to the Mavs LA Lakers game. And so we leaned over, and Stu couldn't get back to Portland, so we thought, okay. Okay. So Stu said, sure, I can do it. And so Steve and I get in this rental Cadillac, it's a brand new car, and we're driving to the Houston Intercontinental Airport, and we pull up in front of the terminal, and Steve says, get the bags. So he pops the trunk, and then he pops the hood. And I get out, I go to shut the trunk, he said, don't shut the trunk. And I said, why? He said, we're gonna leave the car right in front of the terminal. Now, this is pre-9/11. And I said, Steve, we can't do that. But if you knew Steve, it was, it's a rental. We ran and got on the American Eagle flight, sweating and laughing. And Mary, we just looked at each other and we just cracked up. We got to the game. I don't know if you guys remember the game. And every once in a while, Steve and I would just look at each other like, I can't believe what happened, but we did it. Steve did it. I didn't do anything. Steve did it. I'm closing. Most of you knew his strength. I knew his tenderness. I don't know when it started. It was 5 or 6 years ago, and I was getting ready to hang up the phone, and I said, you know, Steve, I love you. And he said, Gary, I love you. First couple times, it was kind of awkward. But invariably, for the last 5 or 6 years, every time we were together or on the phone, we expressed our love for each other. Barb said, you had a vulnerability. You had safety. You had trust. You had an access to Steve. She said, I would sometimes hear you talking and just wonder what that was about. Well, you know what it was about? It was about a deep friendship. And if you want a friend like Steve Farrar, you need to be a friend like Steve Farrar. You need to show up, especially when it's hard and when it's not popular. And he showed up countless times. So I'm closing, but Bev, he was crazy about you. He loved his mother, and he honored you, and he didn't bat an eye when he was providing. Mary, he honored you, he loved you, and he cherished you, Mary Farrar. And he and I have had countless discussions, and I'm still having them in my spirit with him, how much he has finished well and finished strong, a one-woman kind of man, loving Mary Farrar. And to John and Josh and Rachel, he was so proud of you. And there were times as dads where we would not know what's coming with you three and my two, Missy and Sarah. And yet, John, the day of morning hours after your dad's death, you and I were talking and you said, Gary, our dad has prepared us all of our lives for this time. And you know what? You're going to be okay. And we love you. We honor you. The point man beat us all to heaven. He finished well. And you know what? He's in my heart. On his 60th birthday, I went down. The kids, Mary invited me down to surprise him. And Bev, you and Mary and I sat in the living room before I got back to the airport. And he said, Gary, some kid from Dallas, or seminary student, young guy from Dallas, came over to talk to me. And the guy asked me, how have you succeeded in being found faithful at this stage of your life? And he said, a black leather Bible and a red leather chair. And he said, every day I sit in this chair with this Bible, open up the Word of God. And he has done that and impacted me. And he has impacted you. And I know you're grateful for Steve Farrar.
The things you have done for me, things so undeserved, yet you give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be. to God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me, with his power he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Just let me live my life. Let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. With his blood he has saved me, with his
Does it say on the program that I'm next? Okay, good. I just had a moment of doubt. Okay. I'm just thinking after that song, my dad loved hearing David sing. And I honestly don't know if this is a real memory or if I just sort of like patched it together, but here's what it is. It's him with his noise-canceling Bose headphones, because my dad was very sensitive to noise and he liked things to be very quiet when he was like reading or studying or whatever, but he also liked to sing Andrea Bocelli. Do y'all know who that is? Like, my dad actually had a really, really good voice, and he loved Andrea Bocelli, and he would walk around just like sometimes, and I'll really miss that. This past week, so many memories have been surfacing and circling as I process the passing of my precious dad. I've been thinking a lot about my dad's playfulness and creativity. He often told us bedtime stories that he would make up on the fly. My personal favorite was the one about Wally the whale. Apparently, Wally lived in my dad's bathtub when he was a kid. But as whales do, Wally kept growing and growing, and it really started to become a problem. He had to be transferred to the swimming pool, and then to the lake, and then eventually the ocean. He had a wife, Wanda. And and a son, I think it was Willie. And Willie ended up marrying Wendy. Anyway, it was this whole epic saga that unfolded bit by bit, night after night. And we always begged him to tell us more. It was so fun. Fuzzy Wuzzy is another memory that keeps coming up. He got a lot of mileage out of Fuzzy Wuzzy. When we were kids, it goes like this. Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear. Fuzzy Wuzzy had no hair. Fuzzy Wuzzy wasn't really Fuzzy Wuzzy. His timing and delivery were always spot on. Probably like every third time he'd answer a call from me, he'd mix things up with his greeting. So it might be like, Steve Farrar Hotline, or Joe's Pizza. And I'd play along. Oh, hi, Joe. Yeah, do you happen to have like gluten-free crusted pizza? I loved going back and forth with my dad. He had the most adorable sense of humor. He got a kick out of making fun of himself and saying things that we all knew could not be more inaccurate. Like, well, I believe there are many paths. Or another one that Josh reminded me of the other day was, you know, at the end of the day, I just want everyone to like me. And it's a really good thing that he knew how to make us laugh and lighten things up, because I am not sure I have ever met a more intense person in my whole life. Oh my goodness, he was a man of great conviction, deeply principled, intent on doing what was right, no matter what the cost or the sacrifice. He was exceedingly generous. But I'd also like to take some time to reflect on his quality of irritability. he could be irritable at times, short or impatient, and I would get so mad at him for this. Righteous anger like flashing in my eyes. But inevitably at bedtime, he would come sit with me and start in with, well, Rachel, I need to ask your forgiveness for the way I talked to your mom earlier. That wasn't right. I was out of line there. He said I was out of line a lot. That was one of his go-to phrases. He would own his part and seek repair over and over and over again. One of the most significant things he did as a husband and a father was to establish a pattern in our home of rift and repair. He modeled humility, and he valued keeping short accounts with us. I didn't write this down, but Josh was telling me yesterday that his memory of, like, if my dad would leave on a business trip and maybe he didn't feel okay in his spirit about the way he had talked to Josh or my mom, like, Josh just remembered, like, waking up to a note, because maybe he had to leave really early, and the note would just be, hey, I'm sorry for what I did, and it would be specific for what I said. It was not uncommon at all. But as I've been thinking about him, I think what I most treasure about my dad was how he listened, like really deeply listened to me. As you may have noticed, he tended to see things like in black and white more so. And this is just not how I am wired. It's not the confidence and certainty that so often anchored him sometimes didn't resonate with me. But he did not insist that I be the same as him. I felt that he respected our differences and that he gave me permission to question and to struggle and to be honest and entirely myself. What a gift he gave me in his acceptance of me and his tenderness towards me. In times of worry or sadness, I knew he would be ready to offer a hug and words of empathy, Some of my most precious memories with my dad are when I would rest my head on his chest as a little girl. Even in my early adulthood, I have memories of this. And I've been thinking about how he would hold my hand and rub, he always would rub his thumb across it, and sometimes like just a little too hard. But I never said anything. It's funny the things that keep coming up. He knew how to give me space to be sad or worried or confused. I can hear him saying, "Well, Rachel, it's really tough, isn't it? Or it doesn't make sense, does it? It's hard to understand how God would let this happen." And then he might tell me a story of a time when he felt confused or sad or worried. Or the next day he'd call me with a verse he thought might encourage me, or a passage from Martin Lloyd-Jones. For all of his intimidating intensity, he could really be the most wonderful comforter and encourager. Going back to his intensity, I will say at times he could be heavy-handed and confrontational when perhaps, what a given situation called for was a conversation. But here's the thing. If I felt like he mishandled a situation or came on too strong, I could tell him that. And he would always hear me. His first reaction was rarely defensiveness. And I said rarely because I was trying to be accurate. But I really don't remember like a time when he was defensive, which is amazing to me when I just stop to think about that. And it is because he cared deeply about honoring God with his life and honoring God in his role as a father, husband, and friend. My dad's main piece of advice to me when I was single was to look for a man who had a teachable spirit. All the rest will fall into place if he's got that, Rachel, he would say. And he was right. He was right. This last week or so since he died, I have felt heartbroken. I will miss him so much, my adorable dad. I know that he knew that I loved him. We said that to each other a lot. But I wish that I'd had the chance to tell him before he passed. How very proud of him I am. So very proud to be his daughter. So grateful that I got to have him as my dad. Lucky, lucky me. And I'm holding on to the hope of the gospel that was everything to him.
Hello, everyone. I'm John. I'm Steve's oldest son. And first, in order of business, me and Rachel were sitting down front, and she likes to throw me curveballs. And she whispered, "I saw in a press release that the dad still has an unknown cause of death. And so there might be a lot of people here that don't know what actually happened, or people live streaming." So just briefly, I'd like to say that the family now knows that it was a sudden cardiac event, and he was taken very quickly, and so we're thankful for that. And as Dad would say, it was his time. So I wanted to share that with y'all. Now to what I wanted to talk about today. What else could I talk about with being Steve Farrar's son? I want to start out by saying I am so proud, as you can imagine, to have this man as my father. I also want to say, man, I am so thankful that I got to be in this guy's house for 20 years and then walk closely with him for the next 20 of my life. I don't know, the biggest part of me is who I am because who my father was. And so I'm so thankful for that. So I want to talk a little bit about what it was like growing up in his house. You're going to get that perspective from Josh and Rachel as well. But Jeff actually talked about it. You know, in our house, we just had an open dialogue. And, you know, our father set rules in the house, And when you broke the rules, he was the one that enforced them. But within those confines of the rules, there was so much leeway. And some of that was what Jeff talked about. And you said what you thought when you thought it. And he welcomed that. And we would have family discussions, dinner time, like Jeff was talking about. There would be all kinds of discussions and arguments. And I remember even telling my dad, "No, you're wrong on that, you know, and here's why." And this was great. I have to admit, it caused some problems in my marriage early on, you know? And we had to work through that, and I had to kind of create this filter in between my brain and my mouth. But I think I've done that at this point. You know, I often wonder why my first inclination when I hear my boys coming down the hallway is to find a place to hide and jump out and scare them. Why is that? I'll tell you why. That's what my dad did to me. It's the kind of house it was. One of my favorite things that me and my brother did with my dad was we played this living room football game called, well, we called it defensive line. When Jeff and Papa and my dad and his brothers, when they played it, they called it run through the line, which might have been a better name for it. This is a tradition that's been passed down. But how it works is, dad's all-time defense, me and Josh switch off, there's a kickoff, you return the kick, and then you get four downs to smash it through to the couch. The couch is the touchdown. And so we would beg Dad after dinner every night to play this, and we did it for a long time until Dad realized we had outgrown it. I think it was a kickoff return that I tackled Josh into one of the side tables and knocked his front tooth out. We got blood all over the carpet, and Dad said, "Guys, it's time to hang this game up," and my mom was glad about it. But you know, in some ways, my childhood was very normal. Church, we would go to sporting events, sports practice, family dinners. And in other ways, it wasn't normal at all. I'm gonna share some of those memories with you. I remember one time standing on the side of the stage with my dad, some stadium, I think it might've been the Houston Astrodome, and he was about to go on stage to 50 or 60,000 people. And I'm standing there. And I'm nervous. I'm nervous for him. And he's holding my hand, and I said, "Dad, do you ever get nervous before stuff like this?" And he kind of leaned down and said, "John, God made me kind of weird. And you know, I don't get nervous, I just get really focused." And then off he went to speak to the masses. It was unbelievable. I remember going to Christian booksellers conventions. Gary talked about this, and as conferences as well, and there'd be a line backed up for people to get books signed and talk with my dad, and I'd be sitting over the side just wondering, when's this thing gonna be over? And then somebody would come up to me, and they would say, "Are you Steve's son, the one he wrote about in the book?" And I would say, "Yeah," and they'd say, "Do you mind signing my book for me? I don't have time to wait for your dad, but could you sign my book?" And at first it caught me off guard, but after I signed so many, I worked on my signature, and I was whipping it out. But it's not normal to sign books at the age of 12. The other thing it did is that my dad and who he was gave me automatic trust with people. So I remember asking this girl on a date in high school, and I was 17 years old. She called me back and said, "Hey, my dad's out of town. I can't do it. He always has to meet the guy on the first date, so we're gonna have to do it another weekend." And then she called me back like 30 minutes later. She said, "My dad's changed his mind. He didn't know you were Steve Farrar's son. And he's read your dad's books, and so he's going to waive the restriction for you." And so a little piece of advice for fathers of daughters in the room. If your daughter's gonna go out with a guy and he's got bleached blonde hair, he's got gauged earrings, and a hemp necklace, don't waive the restriction. I don't care who the father is. We'll find you out. You know this, long before the private matters are made public to the world, your kids will see it in you. You can't hide from your kids. And I watched this guy like a hawk. So he would travel across the country And he would preach to guys about being fathers and husbands. And I remember one of his talks, I think Gary mentioned it. It's called Being a One-Woman Kind of Man, and he was. But in this talk, he was telling guys how to be this one-woman kind of man. And it starts by not looking at other women. And so this didn't make a lot of sense to me before I hit the teenage years. But then, when I hit the teenage years, I kind of started looking at women. I started noticing. But remember, your kids will watch you like a hawk, and I watched my dad. So a woman would walk in the room, and I would look, and I would look at my dad. And you know what? He would never look, ever. I remember a few times I thought, okay, for sure, he's going to take a long glance at this one. No. This guy's unbelievable. Often at youth camps and summer camps, because I'm Steve Farrar's son, they would say, well, let's have John pray. Or John, why don't you bring us a word? My gosh. You got another kid that can do this? And then inevitably somebody would come up to me and say, John, you're just like your dad. Or you're going to be just like your dad. And I would smile, but in my head I would say, no, I'm not. You don't know this man. So let me ask you a question. After all this stuff that I've told you about my father, his successes, the bar set so high, the expectation of other people, how is it possible that the three of us have made into adulthood, not being crushed by this? I'll tell you how it's possible. Because the very guy that set the bar told you your entire life that that's not success. John, it's not success. My dad would say success is being who God made you to be, whether people recognize you or not. Success is about how you live your life in the quiet moments, in the common moments that we all have every day. It's about loving people. Is that what Jesus said? So I stand here today, and let me tell you, I'm proud to be Steve's son. But you know what? I'm just as proud to be John Farrar. And you know why that is? It's because my dad affirmed me my entire life and who I am. Not Steve Farrar's gifts, my gifts. See, my dad understood that if God is an artist, he paints in many different ways with many different colors. My dad was one skill set. And you know, when he would talk to these guys in his study, you know, people that were having a hard time, he was here today and he was preaching and somebody was left afterwards in a hard time down front, he'd come talk to him. He would talk you through it and then he would affirm you in who you are and your uniqueness in God. And that he's got a plan for your life. So I want to close with this. Dad had a lot of sayings that he would constantly repeat all the time to his kids. Little bits of wisdom, but it was the same ones. And Josh just talked about this last week, but one of them was every time you got out of the car, if you're going to school, a party, church, whatever, he would say, you don't follow, you lead. Be a leader. Another thing is if somebody had a public success, he would quietly say on the side to you, you know, John, that's great, that public success, but character is who you are when no one's around. Nobody's watching. Something else he would say often to his kids, I'm going to say it to you today because if he was here, he would want you to get this message. Put a hand on all of our shoulders, and he would say, God has made you. God has gifted you. He loves you, and he's got a plan for your life. I love you, Dad. Thank you for being a great father and a great friend to me.
Someone mentioned earlier a passage where David said, it was good for me that I was afflicted. And that is how I feel about this past 2 weeks, how good this past 2 weeks have been, how good this affliction has been. I miss my dad. We all miss him deeply, but my heart hasn't been this soft and I don't know how long. And I'm so deeply thankful for what this experience of losing him has done. Dr. Swindoll, what you said about the measure of the tree when it falls, what that's been doing for me this week, all these lessons that my dad taught us, that taught me, that have just always been down here. You know, a lot of them not able to get up into the core of who I am because of stuff in between. Those lessons all this week, every time I wake up as I'm driving around, they're up in my throat, in my heart, in my head, my eyes. Everywhere I look, I see his lessons. And so I just want to start by saying this has been an awesome week. It has been an awesome week remembering him and remembering his lessons. It was also awesome growing up as his son. When I came to consciousness and really woke up to what was going on around me, my dad was kind of famous in the Christian subculture. And that was cool. It was really cool to travel and to go to stadiums. And he would speak to NFL teams and to meet these famous NFL players. And it was amazing to watch what he would do from box seats, watching him on big screens where you saw Troy Aikman throw passes the week before, and you just thought, that's my dad up there. I can't believe that's my dad up there. But I'll tell you what else it was, traveling with my dad and watching him speak to these big crowds, is it was scary. And not because dad's speaking to a lot of people today, but because my dad was nuts. He was nuts. And you knew that if he knew he needed to say something and that someone important at that event didn't want him to say it, he was going to say it louder and he was going to say it twice. I remember a particular event where I learned later that the executives of Promise Keepers, God bless them ultimately for their work, but met with him prior to him going up and highlighted some things from previous messages that they did not want him to emphasize. And that weekend, he doubled down. My dad often ticked off colleagues, often. But as bold as he was in public with his words, I would like to say that eventually he became even bolder in real time in the front lines of his own life. Something happened with him, I think 20, 25 years ago. I could be wrong about the exact timing of it, but he began to trust God in an entirely new way. I remember there being a week, an intense week, where he read Corrie Ten Boom in the Tapestry and in a George Mueller biography, and he felt that God was calling him to never, ever ask for support to his ministry again, that he was just to walk in faith and trust that God would support him. And he thought, this is nuts. How could I possibly proceed in this way? But he decided to do it, and he never asked for support to his ministry again. And henceforth, his ministry was taken care of without his requests. He was a risk taker. He was like a mission field adrenaline junkie. He was an incredible risk taker for the Lord. And what also happened is, I think over the last 20 years, his primary message shifted from being men stand up to men remember manna. He seemed to become more concerned with the providences of God. He went from being a minister to men, and he continued to be that way, but he became a minister of God in tough times. And one way that was so evident in his life was in how he fathered us. You've gotten some glimpses into the fact that his children are very different from him. We have different brains. We process truth a little bit differently. We're skeptical about things that he was confident about. And as he learned about that, and as he walked with us through that, he was incredible in the way that he trusted God with us. He was not anxious. He did not press in. When he spent time with us, he listened. He asked questions. He told stories and evidences from his own life, but he did not push. And because of that, his example has made the providences of God, the sovereignty of God, really the most compelling thing in my own heart. And I want to tell him that today. I want to tell a quick story about how he would father us gently. And it was more weighty in the last few years when it came to faith and understanding what was true. But this is an example more behavior-oriented. When I was in college, went off to Europe for a while, and I discovered that I liked cigarettes when I was in Europe. And I also discovered I liked a bunch of other things, too. And when I came back to Dallas at that time, I was wandering, I was confused, spinning. I did that for about a decade. But I was hiding a lot from him, and I thought I could do that pretty well. I could maintain a surface with him, we could keep things cool, but he didn't need to know a lot about a lot of other things. And one night, he asked me, he said, hey, let's go get dinner. You guys have heard about Cotton Patch Cafe a few times this evening. We went to the Cotton Patch Cafe, just a normal time with Dad. We sat down, everything seems normal. He's selling this very well with me. I think everything is cool. And then he starts telling me about halfway through the meal, he needs to tell me something serious. And something serious, what's going on? And he said, Josh, I'm worried about your mom. Your mom is not doing well. And I said, what's going on with mom? What? He said, she is acting weird. She's not talking to me. She's coming home late. Josh, she started smoking. And he pulled out a pack of cigarettes that he'd found that were mine in the property, and he sat on the table in front of me, and he just smiled. And the reason I don't understand the end of that story is because I know it wasn't mean. I know it wasn't tough. The message was delivered. We had a conversation about where I was at that point. And it was just good. It was good. He checked himself in his pride constantly. He took the advice of his best friend Gary to heart every day in guarding his heart. When I would hand him things to read sometimes when I was growing up, I would get my feelings hurt. I liked to write, and I would be very proud of what I'd just written. But my dad was a voracious reader. He read things very fast. And so I would hand him what I wrote and be so excited about him absorbing it and writing notes, and he'd hand it right back to me as if he hadn't read it. I mean, what the heck, did you not read this? No, he'd read it in depth and in detail. He could tell me everything about it. His brain, his mind was just absolutely brilliant. I do know one thing, that if he had a chance to read this very quickly and hand it back to me, my notes for his own service tonight, the one thing he would edit is the thanking of him directly. He would edit that out, and he would very simply just put God. Thank you, God. And so, along with my brother and sister and mom, I just want to say thank you, God, for our wonderful dad. That's all.
My voice, but I'm going to still go for it, guys. I hope you'll just be patient with me. I have been totally inundated. I have been hearing from people that I didn't have a clue about. I didn't. You know, guys would call from some northeastern state and want to talk. And then I noticed that Steve's phone had messages on his phone. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you see me? I noticed that Steve's had messages on his phone. These were guys, and I started listening to them, and I just couldn't listen to them. They were messages that he had left when they heard that he had died, and they still needed to communicate with him. So they left them. Whoa.
What do we need? I've never been a sound man, but I think if we just put these a little more directly, right here.
Well, there you go. That's better, huh? Okay, good. Thank you, Stu. Anyway, I just want to thank you guys. I know some of you guys came from a long way away. I want to thank you for being here today. This has been this has been a shock. I wanted to wait and have the funeral, or not, this is not a funeral, this is a memorial service, but I wanted to wait for a while so we could pull this thing off. And my boy said, nope, we got to do it now. And my goodness, what has happened in a few days' time is amazing. I just want to thank every one of you for being part of this, every one of you. It's just been a gift to us as a family. We feel honored that you've participated. I don't know how to begin to talk about my husband. If he were here today, he would say, okay, cut, 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 cut. It's really difficult to sum up a 44-year relationship. It is. I mean, and with a man who was larger than life, who was my very best friend, who was the love of my life. So I begin to think about, how do I start? And the only way I can really actually start is by talking about another man. And so if you'll give me permission, I'd like to take a minute to talk about, there have been two great men in my life. I met one of them when I was 14 years old. And then he introduced me to the second great man in my life, Steve. I grew up in a Christian home with a nurturing mom and an authoritarian dad. My mom was one of the sweetest people on the earth. But my dad ruled the roost. And in his book, there was no room for discussion or doubt. And that was pretty unfortunate for me because I was a firstborn and I was very strong-willed. And from a very early age, I was a questioner. I struggled with the huge, difficult mysteries that any thinking person with half a brain and heart would struggle with. How can horrific evil and a sovereign, all-power, good God coexist? How can you possibly trust the reliability of scriptures written by flawed human beings? As I grew older, my questions became more complex. I struggled with the Trinity. I grappled with the purpose of prayer when God already has a sovereign plan. I simply could not accept the weird, offensive idea of command, obey, submission. It was clear to me that a woman could be just as smart and gifted as a man. Why should she be stripped of her dignity as a human being? These were my questions, but I could not talk about them. I had a deep sense of my own sinful heart and genuinely wanted to believe the Bible. I asked Jesus into my life when I was 7 years old, and I was moved by what Jesus had done for me on the cross. But I have to confess, those years were more like the surf of the sea, as James put it, driven and tossed by the wind. I was a walkaway in the making. I remember this night in the age of 14 as if it were yesterday, because it was the same night of an earth-shattering family trauma. All five of us kids vividly remember that night. It was like a grenade hit our family, and for me personally, something shattered deep inside. Ruth Bell Graham once said, "In every pew sits a broken heart." And she was referring to her own heart when she said that. Trauma is inescapable. It's an inescapable part of the fallen human condition. And each of us in this room has our own story to tell. My point in even mentioning this trauma without even telling you what actually happened, is not to focus on the trauma itself, but to understand that trauma is always a catalyst. Lives are powerfully shaped by trauma. Late that night, I ended up alone in my bedroom, in the dark, on my knees, palms outstretched on the bed. And I was just crying. And then I said, God, are you there? I don't remember how long I lay there crying. And so I prayed again. Please, Lord, I am totally crushed here. If you're there, will you just let me know that you're there? That's when, and I don't know any other way to describe this, a palpable presence filled that room. It wasn't what someone would you describe as a charismatic experience. God didn't speak to me or appear in a vision, nor was it some kind of a conjured up meditative state of mind. My faculties were fully intact. It was something very different. I knew that the living God was right there, surrounding me, overshadowing my whole body and soul. I just laid there and breasted and just drank it in. Psalm 139 and other passages of scripture began to enter my mind. I knew the Lord was speaking through them. He was saying to me, I love you. I am behind you and before you. I am right here with you. I am bigger than this terrible thing, much bigger. You can trust me. I realize now that the Trinity of the Living God, Father, Son, and Spirit, was moving in that room that night, moving me toward faith, the kind of faith that Hebrews talks about when it says, faith is an assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. The only passage that comes even close to describing the kind of presence I experienced that night is in Philippians 4. And I've experienced it again this week right after Steve died, where it says, be anxious for nothing, but make your requests known to God, and the peace that surpasses all understanding. That's the catch. It passes all understanding. Will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. I felt myself beginning to pray the prayer of the psalmist in 131. And I grew up with scripture, so I was familiar with scripture, and God was using scripture in the midst of the trauma. This simple prayer says this, O Lord, my heart is not proud, nor my eyes haughty, nor do I involve myself in great matters or in things too difficult for me. Surely I have composed and quieted my soul. Like a weaned child rests against his mother, my soul is like a weaned child within me. Then I said out loud to the Lord, okay, I'm going to trust you like a weaned child. I'm yours. I'm all in. From that night forward, I'm going to follow you and give you the benefit of the doubt. I'm going to choose you with my heart and my soul, and yes, with my mind. The next morning when I woke up, the sun came up, and nothing had changed in my world. Nothing had changed in my circumstances, but everything had changed in my heart. My life was now one of walking with the Lord. I began meeting the Lord every morning, reading scripture and talking with him as my best and dearest friend. I began journaling and writing down my questions and my prayers. A year later, I would go back and see which ones did he answer, which ones are still hanging in the middle of the year. It became a journey. While I had wonderful people in my life, I knew they were just people, just like me. And as the next 15 years went by, I watched God walk me through difficulties and disappointments, and I began to give him space to be God. Some days it was all out war in my mind and in my soul, but I was increasingly learning how to let him be my rock. Did I have questions? Yes. Did I hit roadblocks? Absolutely. But my trust was no longer in any man on the planet. My trust was in the Lord alone. The pattern increasingly became one of stepping back and saying, I don't understand this, Lord, but I'm still all in with you. Help me to wait on you and watch you work. Help me to be still and know that you're God. I found that my tendency towards cynicism softened into a growing quietness and an increasing trust in this great God man who had a plan for me and could be trusted with that plan in the worst of times as well as the best. Now, I told you that introductory part only because it would have been impossible for Steve and I to have had the marriage we did if I had not trusted in that man. Not because of the man I was going to marry, but because of the life that he was calling us to lead. I needed to be rock solid when we didn't have money coming in. I needed to be rock solid when he was in depression, or when his brother died, when his father died. I mean, there were so many times when no one even knew what was going on inside of me, but basically what was happening is that it was me and God, and that was just pretty much it. When I became an old mate at the age of 25 or 26, now see, things have changed, have they not? I remember making a list of the kind of man I needed. I was in seminary in Portland at the time, Portland, Oregon. And I had looked around and decided my future husband was not there. But I was not there for a husband. I was there to go deep into the Word. It was my final year in that program, and I had made a deal with the Lord. I said, if my soulmate hasn't shown up by Christmas, I'll take it that as a no, and I'll begin to make some serious plans for myself. Not long after that, the first great man in my life introduced me to the second great man in my life. One evening, I was gathering my stuff together from my normal back seat in class, and suddenly I noticed a green apple on my desk. Steve introduced himself. I thought that was a little weird. But immediately, he found a way to make me laugh. Steve just has a natural wit that's self-deprecating and hilarious. He was literally the funniest guy I think I've ever known. We laughed a lot. I began to realize that this man was different. He was masculine, authentic to the core, tender, a deep thinker, a lover of the Word. He respected and valued my thinking. He treated me in a way only the best of gentlemen would do. What I didn't know is that we were also in another class together, and that the name of that class was Marriage and the Family. I also didn't know he had been engaged when we started that class to another girl. That was before the green apple, by the way. He was engaged to a very precious girl, and some of you know this story. Nancy was the first woman he'd ever dated seriously. But theirs was a difficult fit They would break up and then get back together on a regular basis. And then one of his buddies would keep saying to him, bro, your thinking is all messed up. You've got to start thinking about what you need. Does she meet your needs? Does she fit you? Then when we were in the class, we began with the premarital part. In the class, and Dr. Howard made it very clear why their relationship was not working. When that became clear to him, the next day he went and broke it off, and that was it. Now, they've been dating for a couple of years, I think, right, Bev? Something like that? He had a group of close buddies from the South in that class that knew me well. When Steve told them he had completely cut the cord with Nancy, they said, well, it's about time. Then they pointed to the back of the class. Can you guys hear me? I feel like I'm losing it. They pointed to the back of the class where I was sitting and said, what you need is a good Southern girl, and she's right over there. Now, I know that what I'm about to tell you may seem slightly abnormal, and you may want to remove your children from the congregation. It may be even just plain outright crazy, but anybody who knew Steve would tell you that normal was never an adjective to describe him. There was something much bigger going on, though, and I need to say that before I tell you what happened next. The truth is that the Lord had been preparing the two of us for one another for a quarter of a century. He'd been shaping the trajectory of our lives, moving us and setting up our first date, even. Had we met a month or even a week sooner, we would have simply moved right on by one another like two ships in the night and gone off to who knows where. So much of God's providence is all about timing. Usually he works slowly, but sometimes he works in the blink of an eye. And this was one of those rare blink of an eye moments. So here we go. We had our first date. We go out for dinner. He never drinks wine. Right, guys? I mean, you guys know, never does he take a sip. He introduced me to wine that night. I don't know how long we were out together on that first date, but it was hours. And the reason we were together for so long is because we connected from the get-go at level 10, if you know what the levels are. And we just couldn't stop talking. It was like he read my book and I read his. He read my heart, I read his. We were on the same path. We had the same calling. Then we decided, well, we got to stop tonight. We'll pick it up tomorrow. And he convinced me to skip class, which I never did. And that's when my professors began to realize something funny was going on. What's interesting is that within three weeks, now this is going to sound a little crazy for some of you guys, we were engaged. We spent a lot of time together those 3 weeks. I'll tell you that, we did. and I think Steve wrote a book several years later, anyway, I don't think this would be in that book, for sure, how to ruin your life. But, this was part of God's weaving into our lives. So then we got engaged. Now, but I need to tell you how that happened, because see, I think most people think that I'm a really quiet, sort of chill. I just kind of let him lead, and then he just, I follow. That's not really how it works at our house. And if you're close enough to us, you know that for a fact. So the night that he was going to ask me to marry him, I knew he was going to ask me to marry him. And he drove up to Mount Hood. We get it. We're going up this, and I think he's got something. He's got a plan here. What's he got? What's he doing? And then he gets sort of to the top, and we're looking out over the city. And he's having a little bit of a hard time. He says, I've got a question to ask you. And I said, well, can I answer it first? He said, yes. And I said, the answer is yes. And that's how it happened. Now, it was interesting how the family reacted. My family, as I was just informed yesterday at the burial, thought that I had basically given up and that I had lost my mind. They really did, because I would never do anything like this. It just wasn't me at all. Steve's family thought that he was on a major rebound, right? So everyone was concerned. Of course they were. It was understandable. But once we met, of course, Mike gave me a good, Mike really checked me out closely. Once we met, I think people began to realize, you know what? These guys are really meant to be together. So we started our premarital class with him being engaged to Nancy. We end our premarital class by getting extra credit in premarital counseling with Dr. Howard Hendricks. I mean, no. I mean to say Grant Howard, who did that class. So anyway, I mean, it's been a wild ride. An amazing ride with Steve. Our children will tell you that I do think that God gave us a rare marriage. I think the kind of friendship we had was very special. I treasure that. I'm going to miss that. I wanted to talk with him about this talk. I wanted him to give it a little run through, and he wasn't there to do that. We were a team. We did a lot of things together. And now I've lost my place because my notes are just all over the place. If you'll give me a second, I'll figure it out. But what I wanted to say, is that in spite of the quickness of our relationship and how it came together, we did wait 9 months against Steve's better instincts, but we did. We waited 9 months. Is this little quote by Edith Schaefer, he's a great weaver of the tapestry of your life. He weaves our choices, both bad and good, our personalities and gifts, and yes, the traumas that so deeply shape us. He weaves us so wisely that he literally has it all down to a nanosecond in order to accomplish his work in your life. I think I want to just give you an example of how that came to be. Interestingly enough, before I went to seminary, I'm going long. I'm sorry, guys. How long? Thank you. Right before I went to seminary, I went through a year of a long depression. And it was just another one of those traumas that come along in life. But it was a trauma that God used to inform me that I was not in the right place. I was not in the right slot. He hadn't wired me for winning souls. And that's what Campus Crusade for Christ was all about. He had wired me for mentoring women and working within a church body, discipling. So I emerged from that depression not only a better woman, but a much more clear and independently focused woman. I became hungry to go deeper into the Word, and that's how I ended up at seminary. And the only program in the country that had music was at Western, and that's how I ended up there, and I had some of the top guys. I mean, it was an awesome experience. How could I possibly known, however, that Steve would go through a deep, life-altering depression 5 years into our marriage, crying some days for hours at a time and wondering if he was headed for the loony house? But God knew that. He knew I would understand Steve's depression. He knew, I knew he'd be okay. I knew he'd come out of it a better man, a more fitted man, a man being better prepared to do whatever God had for him. And the reverse side, Steve was the kind of guy that I needed in my life. And I'm just gonna just tell you just a few of the things about Steve, and it's hard to narrow them down. But I needed someone who could lead me, because I was a leader, and I was very strong-willed, and I needed somebody that I could trust to lead me, someone who valued my input, and who would move heaven and earth to see me flourish. Steve didn't only love godly manhood, he loved having a strong woman at his side. God knew that I needed a man who was not threatened by strength in a woman. And how much did I need a teachable man? Oh, but I needed that. A man who was quick to listen and readily admit his faults. Steve actually taught me how to initiate the process of restoration, ask forgiveness, and not say, I'm sorry if I hurt you. He taught me how to keep short accounts and how to ask forgiveness the right way. I was not good at this. I was terrible at this. If he confronted me, I was so defensive. And so he just kind of walked me through the process, and he began to teach me how to become teachable. God knew that I desperately needed a man who didn't see leadership as a means of propelling himself and making himself great. He knew that I needed a man who was authentic and kept his word. He knew, and I don't need to tell you stories, but since our kids have already told them, I mean, he just kept short accounts. He'd call me deplaning, and he would say, I'm sorry for the way I walked out of the house. And I'd just laugh at him, because he actually was erring on the side of having too much of a conscience at times. But I'd much rather have that, wouldn't you? The Lord also knew I needed a man who could fight for me, protect me, provide for me. He was absolutely determined to provide for me, even if it meant driving a truck for a year, which he did during that a year when he didn't have a job. So, Stu, he was a tender warrior, and Gary, he guarded his heart. A few nights ago, Bev and I sat down. Dear sweet Bev, she's been living with us, about 6 years now? And she's just part of the household. She's just part of the family. We sat down and we stayed up like we typically do until about 1 in the morning, and we talked about the highlights of Steve's growing up years. It's impossible to tell you all of those highlights. In fact, I have pages of them, okay? But I'm just going to give you a few little things. But before I do that, I just want to say something to you, Bev. You were such a wise mom. And Steve adored you. He loved having you live with us these past years. He loved hanging out in your little apartment. He loved going out on those special rides where you guys didn't even know where you were going to go. You were just going to go ride. You knew how to handle him perfectly, and I was watching you and learning from you. You knew how to be sassy but sweet. You knew how to tease him and make him laugh. And you had a special way of loving him well. He had two women keeping tabs on him the last 6 years and taking care of him. And I thank the Lord every day that when we go home today, you're going to be there to be with me, my best friend and my buddy. Beverly, he treasured you. And I honestly couldn't ask for a more merciful gift in my life than to have you there with me as my best friend now that he's gone. Steve grew up in a very different kind of home. And I think you've gotten a feel for it, but you can imagine it was very open. They had discussions, they went back and forth. I don't care what it was. They had their feet up and they were talking, they were interacting. His dad was as open as a book. His sons could talk to him about anything. His dad got up every morning at, I think it was 6 o'clock, sharp. He was like a military guy. And read the Bible and prayed. And Steve watched that. From as a tiny little tot, he watched his dad do that. So he had a very wonderful home that he grew up in. One story I'm going to tell you about how much he loved his dad. I hope I get this right, Bev. He was entering his freshman year of high school, and the coach had seen him play basketball. Am I right about that? Yeah, Jeff knows. And the coach was actively recruiting him for the team. And Steve said to him, well, sir, I won't be able to play this semester because my dad won't let me play until I get my grades up. The coach said something like, well, then I have no respect for your dad. And Steve said, well, sir, you need to know I'm never going to play for you. And he didn't. He loved basketball, but he decided, if that guy doesn't respect my dad, I'm not playing for him. When he was 3 years old, he would preach. He felt called to preach at the age of three, if you can believe that. They had a little table. I think you call it like a donut table. A coffee table, okay. But it kind of looks like a donut, right? And he would come home from service that Sunday morning, and Jim would say, so what did Pastor Ward teach on? And Pastor C.M. Ward was quite the man. I don't know if you know who he is, Chuck, but he was a great expositor of the scriptures. So Steve would get up and copy him at the age of three, and he would preach. He would stand there and preach. Then later he would get out in his little sandbox, and he'd line up his little buddies. And he preached to them the message. One day, when one of his brothers was being baptized, the C.M. Ward brought him up on the stage because, of course, it was a family activity, right? He said, what are you going to do when you grow up? And he said, I'm going to be a preacher. I think he was seven at about that age. He was a very unusual guy. I think he was uniquely called by God. I think it took him a while to figure out that calling was especially to men. But I will never forget sitting on that porch out on Myra Road when Steve was weeping and crying in his deep depression. I will never forget sitting on that porch and saying to him, you know what? This is a great time for you because you can be home with your kids. You don't have a job. Nobody wants you to come and preach. And yeah, that's depressing. I get it. I totally get that, you know. But he said, but you can be here with the kids and hang out with them. And he hadn't even thought of that. And so, I mean, he really began to just hang out with the kids all the time. They played basketball, they cleaned the yard, they did everything together. And I said, the other thing that I think is really good about this is, here's how I ended it. I said, Babe, that's what's his name. We actually teased about that going on his driver's license because that was his name. I called him Babe. I said, Babe, one of these days, I think you're going to be shocked because I think you're going to be traveling all over the country teaching men. And he said, what? Have you lost your mind? And I said, he said, why would you say that? And I said, well, because every time you preach, you talk to the guys. And the women are listening in, and I'm acutely aware of the fact that you're talking to the men. It took him a while, but then it happened. I just want to tell you one other thing, that it was very precious because, you know, Steve died in my mind as a young man. I thought he had lots of years left. I really did. We all thought he had a lot more time with the grandchildren, that he'd be going to ball games with these little boys. And so God was very merciful. That week was Valentine's week. So I gave him, I usually write something very, very long to him on Valentine's. And that week, I just gave him a card that I put on his bed pillow. And it said, you really are my one true love. You have been God's gift to me, babe. I love you. Then the night before he died, he crawled into bed and he was crying and he was in pain. What I didn't know is that he had probably had an original heart attack. And in that week, he had been in a lot of pain. He actually did his last message in a lot of pain. And none of the guys knew it. If you go watch it, you would never know it. But he was in excruciating pain. But he crawled into bed that night, and he was crying. And he said, Mary, he was just saying, I can't believe you've put up with me all these years. And I just was like, what are you saying to me? He said, no, I'm dead serious. This is how he was, wasn't he, guys? And he said, you know, I was a tough guy to live with. And he said, you were so patient with me. I can't believe what you went through with me all these years. And I said, okay, well, let me set this record straight. And then I began to tell him, while he's crying, lying there crying, and I just begin to tell him all that he had taught me, what he had done for me as a husband, what kind of dad he was with his children, what kind of grandfather he was being with those little kids. And I said, you know what? You're the best thing that ever happened in my life. And that was the night before he died. It's precious to me that God would have allowed me to have had that kind of conversation with him, because we just didn't know. We didn't know. I want to read something from Finishing Strong. Are you guys familiar with this book? It's probably one of my favorite books that Steve wrote. And then I'm done. it's actually at the end of the first chapter of that book. And it's a great book, I think. But he had actually preached on this situation 2 weeks ago, 2 weeks prior to his death. It was when the disciples were in the boat. And then he went on to say that we are in the boat with Jesus now. In this boat, Jesus is the coxswain, and each of us is rowing. We're rowing daily, and we're rowing diligently. And as we fix our gaze upon him, he will pace us. The race will be over. Oops, excuse me. He will pace us. He will encourage us, and he will instruct us. And then one day, in an instant, the race will be over. We'll cross the finish line, and life on earth will be over. And because we have listened to him, because we have obeyed him, we will realize that we didn't just finish. We finished strong. Babe, Thank you for finishing strong. You did it. You lived a great life, and you finished strong. And I love you for it. These flowers, by the way, I'm just going to tell you this. I brought them up here, and then I forgot all about them. After we got engaged so quickly, I freaked out, and he called me. And I couldn't even talk on the phone. I was so freaked out. It was the next day. And, I mean, I was cotton mouth. So the doorbell rings in about 30 minutes, and he's at the front door, and he has a dozen yellow roses. And that became our thing, just to let you know. He had a dozen yellow roses, and he looked at me, and he was shocked. He had never, that was back in the days when you had platform shoes. He didn't know how short I was. He said, okay, I'll take you anyway.
I met Steve and Mary at Western Seminary in the early 70s. I'm sensitive to where we are here, so I'm going to reach and talk fast as Steve does from time to time. Okay. Steve pulled into the parking lot when he was starting seminary, and he was driving a brilliant orange German sports coupe kind of car. I think we heard the wheels squeal when he pulled in. And he got out of the car and started seminary. Now, I didn't see anything like this, but it would have been typical for me to have seen him. You know how Kramer does on Seinfeld? He would come out of that car like that, saying, Bible theology, where's Rodmacher? Let's go. Yeah, that's Steve. And you heard a lot about that. And then there's that big tender guy inside that some of us got to see from time to time. I didn't get to be with him as much as I wanted. I call him a Mount Hood friend. You've heard it mentioned tonight. You know, the Cascades run like a spine down the Oregon, and they divide the state, and they stop all the marine layer that comes off the Pacific Ocean. They stop it, and it clouds, and it fogs, and you can't see anything, and you can't see the mountain. But the phrase is big in Oregon, the mountain's out today. Steve is my Mount Hood friend. I don't always get to see him. We're quite a bit away from one another geographically, but I got to spend some time with him along the way in ministry, and I found him to be what you have heard him to be tonight. He was the kind of a man that you wanted to ride the river with. And so we didn't get to ride the river too often, but I would get up and I would say, as I would see on a beautiful morning in Oregon when the sun's shining, the mountain's out today. And whether you could see the mountain, whether I could see Steve, I knew he was there like the mountain, strong, stable, immovable, and snow white in so many ways. Now, he wasn't entirely snow white. He had a sense of humor that at times could be a little bit perverted. Now, here's what I mean. The three amigos, here's Gary and myself and Steve, and we're at a conference. Well, we're going to the conference. In fact, we're here at Dallas. Gary and I fly in. We're going to meet Steve at the airport. We're going to fly to Arkansas and have this conference. And Gary and I are in the airport. And this is the way I remember the story. Who knows if it was that? You come up and tell it. But anyway, Steve pulls up in his Suburban, and we pile in the car. And we're going to go park it, I guess. I don't know. But he says, hey, you know how Steve was. How far is it to Fort Smith? Only Rosberg could guess, so he said somewhere like under 300. Steve says, hey, we can drive, forget the plane. And that's when we made one of those turns that he was describing up over the grass and up onto the next object so we could go out that way. And then we drove to Fort Smith. And we got to Fort Smith, and the conference opened on Friday night. sometimes I thought ministering with Steve was like traveling with John the Baptist. You know what I mean? We got to the conference. Steve was so strong, so capable, so forward-looking, so on task, that he never bothered to look back. He was always moving forward. What's the next challenge? Where do we go next? Well, the conference opens. The musician is really good. The guys are really worshiping and coming together. It's going to be a great night. Steve gets up. It's going to be a great message about never going to battle alone. You got to have a battle buddy. You got to stick together. And if you don't stick together, you're going to get picked off. If you don't believe it, watch this. And then he shows a clip from Full Metal Jacket. It's dark. It's sad. Guys are dying. And you can feel the audience going. And he worked so hard to get him back. And he couldn't get him back. And so as he's coming off the platform, and I'm going on to the platform, he's just introduced me, he stops me halfway to the pulpit, puts his hand on my shoulders, grins, and says, "Recover from that." That's so Steve. If he'd have been in the Bible, if he'd have been alive in the time of the Bible, he would have been in Philippians chapter 2, I think, where Paul said, "This guy you hold in high, highest regard." He would take any risk. In fact, Epaphroditus did risk his life. But what Paul was saying, "This is my brother. We are kindred spirits. We're from the same sources." I felt that with Steve. It connected. Not only my brother, but you, he is my fellow worker, literally my fellow energy spender. When you were with Steve, you got more energy. We were together in ministry, so strong, so helpful. And he was my fellow soldier. He was a warrior, and he was tender, and he was always on task when we were in ministry. The mountain's out a lot in my life. I can see it, I can feel it because of a guy like Steve. We'd get a call. One time he's had some issues with a tax or something, and he said, "Well, what do you do with the taxes and all the royalties and that stuff?" And I said, "Well, I just pay my taxes." He said, "Well, now there's a novel idea. Maybe I'll try that." You know? He was so honest, so authentic, so real. He was what I think of when I think of a man after God's heart. And I believe that passage is talking about David. That little "after" word is not so much a preposition as it is an adverb. He was after God's heart. He didn't have a perfect heart. Look at his life. But he was a God pursuer. And he would take his heart in his hands and he would run to the Lord and say, "You got to fix this. I don't know what, you help me." Have we heard that memorialized today? The biggest and strongest of all of us is also the tender recipient of the grace of God. That's what gave David the courage to go out there and say to the big guy in the Valley of Elah, "You come at me with that stupid spear. I come against you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel." Kaplunk. That's what I think of when I think of Steve. That kind of a guy. I love him for it. But in light of our time, let's just ask one question as we get ready to close the service, and we will finish out as it's scheduled there. Where is our brother now? We think we need him here. God had other plans and intentions. Where is he now? If you think Steve could have a good time in life, we can't even imagine what he's experiencing now. Here's the passage. I can hear him, like Paul, saying, "For me to live has been Christ, and to die, gain." You're the ones I'm feeling sorry for. You're left here. I'm not. It's gain. It's profit. It's advantage. It's winning. It's all the right things, and I'm in the middle of it. That's where I think our brother is today. What are the death benefits? Real briefly. What are the death benefits for a believer? If it really is gain, what's the profit? You know, the two great apostles, several of them. There's too many of them. But here's Paul and here's Peter. There was a lot of Peter's genes in our brother. He'd have been the first one with the sword out. And Jesus, by the way, I think, cautioned him, just because it's a matter of timing. You need to get a sword. Sell your cloak if you need to. There'll come a day for it. But here's Peter, who has come around. And here is the Sons of Thunder. There would have been three if Steve was there in the New Testament. And the Sons of Thunder became the beloved apostles. That's the way it ought to be, because we're all sinners and we're changing, transforming from glory to glory to glory. That's the way it should be. So here's one. Here's Peter, the big fisherman, the strong guy. Probably not unlike the way I pictured Peter like I picture Steve. And Peter says this at the end of his life, I want you always to be in remembrance. So we started with remembering, we close with remembering. You must be in remembrance, he says. I will always stir you up by way of reminder. And then he talks about some strong things. He refers to his own death, and he relates to it at one point with one word that's just kind of a casual laying aside of a robe. That's all death is for Steve and all of us who believe in Jesus. It's just a casual laying aside of the robe. But then he uses another word that was all over the pages of Hebrew history. That's that huge word, the time of my exodus, the time of my departure is at hand. There's freedom in that little word, exodus. It's huge freedom. It's freedom to be away. It's deliverance. It's getting out. It's beyond all that bondage and all that sin that we hate in ourselves and all of that stuff. It's an exodus. It's a delivery away from. He is away from all that bugs you and me. My friend, dear friend, Randy Alcorn describes it this way. He says, the joy and fulfillment in heaven will erupt not only from positive experiences, but also from what is not there. This is where our brother is. There's no arthritis. He doesn't hurt anymore. No handicaps, no cancer, no mosquitoes, no taxes, no bills, no computer crashes, no weeds, no bombs, no drunkenness, no traffic jams, no accidents, no door locks, no phone calls, no phone calls selling storm windows at dinner time. No mental illness, no pretense, no wearing masks. This was before the pandemic, but it's a good word anyway, isn't it? Yeah, there's no masks in heaven. There are close friendships, but there's no cliques. There's laughter, lots of laughter, but no put-downs. There's intimacy, true intimacy, the kind we all want, but no temptation to immorality. That's where Steve is. He's out there, exodus, away from. And then the great apostle Paul, who also was a type A personality. You know, our Lord chooses to use guys like this. Doesn't use all the monks in the world, but he sure used them, these guys. And here's a type A who writes at the end of his life in his swan song, the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought the good fight. I've finished the course. I've kept the faith. Steve was one of those few guys that seems to recognize that life on this planet is a long, unfinished war. Ever since we left Eden, when we moved out of Eden, there's been constant battles on this planet, not just physical, mostly spiritual. But this planet's at war continually. And Steve recognized that. And he recognized that if we're going to see the church flourish, and if we're going to win the battle daily, we got to get to the men. Because Steve believed, as I do, that when the men get it right, everybody wins. Every wife, every woman, every child. When men get it right, everybody wins. And so Steve devoted his life strategically to that. So Paul says, I have fought the good fight, I've finished the course, I've kept the faith, the time of my departure is at hand. And then he uses a word that Peter hasn't referred to. It's a funny little word, so we get our word analysis from it. It's analusis. It's to take it apart, to put it back together again. That's what an analysis is. That's what analusis is. It's to put it apart and put it back together again so that it's fully functional. To separate in order to resolve. That's where our brother is. He's separated from us right now in full resolve in the presence of Christ. That's what we need. That little word was used in the ancient world for a number of things. For one, it was the launching of the ship. It was the raising of the tie downs and throwing it off the moor so that the ship could sail, so that the ship could experience what it was made for. That's what Steve has experienced. It's a total analusis. He's been freed from being tied down here. That's a strong thing. That's a great death benefit. But where that little word is used most often, at least in my mind in reading ancient history, it's the breaking down of a military camp. The time of my breaking down my military camp is over. I'm done. I'm out of here. My victory is assured. That's what he's talking about. I've fought the good fight. The war's over. Can you imagine what that must feel like? No more battle. No more crying. No more having to watch friends go down. No more. Camp is broken. The battle is won. As Isaiah said, as he's announcing Jesus' arrival, the boot of the booted warrior and the cloak soaked in blood are on the fire. It's over. There is victory. It's assured. The closest I've ever come to that kind of a feeling was when what the guys called in Vietnam the Freedom Bird left the ground in Vietnam. We'd been there a year. We'd obviously survived. Some of our friends hadn't. We didn't know why we did as opposed to them. But we were going home. For us, the war was over. I'll never forget the sensation when there's, there 200 of GIs in the plane, and the pilot shoves that throttle forward, and it sets you back, and you start moving ahead, and you can pick it. You're picking up the momentum, and then all of a sudden, you can feel him pulling the power back and the power up and the ailerons, whatever it is making that thing rise. And then the pilot's voice comes on the plane and he says, "Wheels up, guys, wheels up." That's real strong. And for Steve, it's wheels up a couple of weeks ago. He has been delivered from all the pain and discouragement and disaster on the planet, and he has arrived at home. Wheels up, boys, we're going home. It's over. We're going where we belong. We're going to dwell with the one who made us, who has told us he will dwell with us forever. Here's another little account from my friend Randy. This is a fictional account, of course, but Alcorn has a scholar's mind and a very sacred imagination, and I think he's probably not far off. We rejoined our comrades in the great camp of Caras, his word for heaven in this little novel, embracing and shedding tears and slapping each other on the back. That'll be a good day. The warriors around me turned toward the masses of untold millions gathered in grace, and the army began to sing. I added my voice to theirs and sang the unchained praises of the king. Only for a moment did I hear my own voice, amazed to detect the intensity of the whole. One voice, even mine, made a measurable difference. And then from then on, I was lost in the choir, hardly hearing my own voice and not needing to. I'm not about me anymore. I've been delivered fully. And then suddenly, multitudes before us sang back to us, and our voices were drowned by theirs. We who a moment earlier seemed the largest choir ever assembled now proved to be only the small worship ensemble that led the full choir of untold millions, now lost to themselves as well. We sang together in full voice, to him who made the galaxies, who became the lamb who stretched out on a tree, who crossed the chasm, who returned the lion forever. I looked at the great throne, and upon it sat the king, the audience of one. The smile of his approval swept through the choir like fire across dry wheat fields. And in the moment, I knew with unwavering clarity that the king's approval was all that mattered or ever would. Well done, Steve Farrar. We memorialize you and your model amongst us. Give us more Steve Farrars. And Mary, that day he pulled into that little orange car and piled out of there looking for theology and all that. We didn't know the biggest guy on campus would find the smallest, slightest, little petite woman on campus and spend his life with her. And she got a rope around his ankle and things worked out. I've worshiped with you today. It's good. And kids, can I call you that? He is proud of you, more now than ever. What a heritage. What a responsibility. What a stewardship the Farrar clan has. It's a good thing. And just before we sing, one final word that if I don't share, when I get to heaven and join my battle buddy there, he's going to say, why didn't you? And can you see him doing that? That's his favorite gesture. There may very well be in a group our size somebody here who hasn't yet bowed the knee to Jesus, doesn't yet know who he is or how he is. And just in a couple of seconds, let me share with this simply thing. You don't need an aisle to walk. You just need a couple of things. You need to believe that Jesus is everything that he said he is, the creator of the universe and the savior of the world. You just need to believe that in your heart. And you need to believe that you are who he said you are, a sinner. You can't make it. The standard you see in heaven is perfection, and none of us have it. Some of us may have what we think are B's or C's or D's or A's or F's, but if we all had to come out to my state of Oregon, get on the beach and swim to Hawaii, we wouldn't make it, any of us. Some would get 5, some get 10 yards, maybe some 50 meters, maybe some 20 miles, but nobody stands up to the standard, which is the righteousness of Christ, which is why he sacrificed himself for you as the greatest warrior who ever lived and the tenderest heart who ever walked on this planet. So if you haven't accepted Jesus, wouldn't it be something if you do on the occasion of Steve's memorial service and you get up to heaven and Jesus will be there and he says, oh, your one needs to talk to Farrar, and you have a reunion with Steve from this service. We're going to sing a final hymn of worship, and then I'm going to close briefly in prayer, and we're going to go out of here worshiping through a song that was written by another spiritual man who was a spiritual warrior and who understood that his God, like David's God, same God, was an awfully mighty refuge and forest. So Sammy, you come and lead us in the hymn, and then I'll pray briefly and we'll depart. And may I just say at this point, when it's time to leave, would you just let the family get out there so that they could be with any and all of you, okay? Let's sing, Sammy.
Mary had said this is one of Steve's favorite songs that he was singing around the house recently. So she wanted you to join in with us on this. Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Is creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole?
Is anyone
seals and open the scroll?
The Lion of Judah
who conquered the grave.
same. He is worthy. He is worthy of all blessing and honor and glory. He is worthy of this.
He
does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And is Jesus our Messiah? Oh, forever those he loves,
he does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died, the ransom to save from every people and tribe, every nation and tongue. He has made us kingdom and priests to God, to reign with the Son. He is worthy. He is worthy of all blessing and honor and glory. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy of it. He is he worthy? Is he worthy?
He
is. He
is. Please pray with me. Father, give us more Steve Farrars. Until your Son returns, the perfect one, give us more God chasers, more hearts after God, more who will pursue the truth like our brother Steve. I pray your comfort for his family, for you're watching over each one of them. I thank them before you for sharing their father with so many, traveling so often. I thank you for when he did travel to minister to so many in so many places, it always was with the sword of the Lord, the book of truth. And I thank you that Steve was not afraid to wield that sword. Pray you would give us more Steve Farrars. Help us, Father, to stand before you with open palms and open hearts and ask what you would have of us as a result of having heard the testimony of this larger-than-life and very normal human in all human respects. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.